लाइक टू डिस्कस अबाउट द डिफरेंट साइकिल ऑफ द इंजन, बेसिक्स ऑफ कंबशन. नाउ लेट मी स्टार्ट विद व्हाट इज द पर्पस ऑफ इंजन एंड व्हाट इज एन इंजन. इंजन इज ए कन्वर्जन मशीन विच कन्वर्ट द केमिकल एनर्जी इन टू द हीट एनर्जी एंड द हीट एनर्जी इज कन्वर्टेड इन टू द मैकेनिकल एनर्जी एंड हाउ इट इज कन्वर्टेड दैट वी लुक एट दैट. सो बेसिकली द साइकल्स आर यू कैन लुक एट हियर. दिस इज ए इनटेक साइकल. सो इनटेक वाल्व ओपन जस्ट बिफोर टॉप डेड सेंटर. It is not at top dead center. Now we will discuss why it is before top dead center. So this is the intake. Intake is taking place, which is shown as the blue line, and then complete, and the intake valve closes here. Theoretically, it may close here at BDC, but in real engine, the inlet valve closes after bottom dead center. Then when the here inlet is closed, exhaust is closed, so this is we call it compression stroke. And here somewhere very near to DDC or just before TDC, you can see the spark. We are igniting the air and fuel mixture, and that combustion is initiated, and this will cause the power increase in temperature inside the combustion chamber, and the power is generated, and then exhaust valve opens, and then this is exhaust is coming out, and exhaust valve closes here. Now the question arises. This is the cycle diagram again, valve timing diagram. The same cycle on the PV is shown here also. Inlet valve opens here. This upper circle showing the intake valve opening duration, and intake valve closes here. So the value of this is coming 180 degree plus this plus this. So this is coming around 232 to 60 degree crank angle, which will vary from engine to engine. Now my question is, this session I would like to make a little bit interactive. My question is, why inlet valve opens before top dead center and why it closes after bottom dead center? Yes, please. Because we would like to make this session interactive. So now from the center, I would like to know if anybody is would like to answer that why theoretical cycle is inlet valve should open at top dead center and it should close at BDC. But in actually in the engine, inlet valve opens, start opening before TDC and it closes after BDC. Why? Yeah. So you start little bit. So your one point is this is the to reduce the wear and tear of the engine, right?
And also the traction will instantly. It will take time.
Okay.
But if it starts before the
okay, so then second is to fill the charge, right? Properly. Okay, anybody else? He has given his opinion with two reasons.
Hello?
Right.
Hello?
Yes.
Sir, I am from Pandit Ramadharji Duhari College of Polytechnic Sindhauli.
Uh-huh.
In my opinion, this process is done for a long time because in cylinder there is flue gases which are burned. We have to remove them completely. So for this reason, engine the inlet valve is open for a long period.
And what about exhaust valve? It is not open for a longer period. It is for shorter period, or because to remove the exhaust gases, exhaust valve is used, not intake.
I mean, then the fresh air makes a pressure, and by which the fuel gases begin to get out from the burning chamber.
No, that is quenching. Generally, that is more useful in two-stroke engine.
Hello.
Yes.
Basically, we have to increase the volumetric efficiency.
How the volumetric efficiency will increase?
The valve is open for a long time. Mass of air in the cylinder.
So, you mean to say, suppose I keep the inlet valve opening, even I even don't close here. Suppose here I keep it open. You mean to say that volumetric efficiency will increase further? Pardon? Okay. So you feel that it is to improve the volumetric efficiency of the engine, right? Okay, anyone else? And similarly, what I am doing, if you look at the exhaust valve opens, it should open at BDC in the exhaust stroke, but it is also opening before the BDC here. And exhaust valve is opened, it is opened, open. So 180 degree plus this 40 or 50 degree. And again, it is not closing at TDC, it is closing at after TDC. You can see here. So this is the exhaust valve opening duration. So exhaust valve also open before bottom dead center and closes after top dead center. Why? Actually, this valve timing is very critical for engine performance and even for emissions point of view. That's why I want to emphasize on this particular valve timing diagram. So anyone from any center? Okay, that was for intake. Now we are talking about the exhaust valve. Exhaust valve is opened before BDC and now it is closed after I am able to read that is it is opened before TDC so that sufficient pressure difference is maintained for proper suction of the charge. Okay, anybody else? And you see in the diagram, this is the time here inlet valve is also open and exhaust valve is also open. So this period, this one, both valves are open and this is known as valve overlap period. It is written overlap. So inlet valve just beginning in the opening and exhaust valve is in the closing stays. Both are open, and that is the overlap. Now, few faculty members from different centers, they have given their comments. More or less, that was right, that one is to increase the volumetric efficiency and to reduce the, because you cannot suddenly open and close the walls. But there are other important reasons behind this. What is happening when I am breathing the air from the atmosphere, piston during suction stroke, piston is moving from top dead center to bottom dead center like this. Piston is coming down. When the piston is coming down, vacuum is created inside the combustion chamber, inside the cylinder, and the air will come. So air will follow the movement of the piston. So because valve opening is mechanical, it cannot open suddenly, so it start open here. It start open here, so that by this time, when it is near to TDC, it is opened significantly, so that air can fill in. Now air is following, air is coming. Suppose now this is the bottom dead center. Piston has come here. Now when the piston is here, the air may not be, air is still coming. So if I close the inlet valve here, so it is stopping the air which is coming due to the ram effect. It is called ram effect, like sort of a movement of inertia of the air. And if I close here, you are stopping the air. So what I do, the piston start moving upward, and here I am closing the valve so that the ram effect may be utilized properly. So you will charge more air. But suppose it is not optimized properly, then piston is moving upward, and if I am closing here, that there is a possibility when I, that whatever air is there, that is pushed back into the intake. So I, this time is very important, and this may vary from speed to speed of the engine. At lower speed it may be different, at higher speed it may be different, optimum valve closing time. And that's why, have you heard about the concept of variable valve timings? Anybody from the center? VVT, variable valve timings? Anybody from the center? Because this valve timing, when I am closing the valve, this depends upon the engine speed. This timing may be good for 2000 RPM. For 5000 RPM, this may not be good. So earlier we were keeping the valve timings constant. But in new engines, a concept is coming which is known as VVT, variable valve timings. Is anybody aware about this VVT? Anybody from any center? Yeah. Huh. So have you heard about this and how it is changed?
I don't know how it changed, but I have
Okay, good. So that concept is known as VVT, and advanced engine like Honda engine, you can see there is a written VVT. That means variable valve timings. It means the valve timings are continuously changed depending upon the speed of the engine. Now, very important aspect of the engine combustion. Look at this very carefully. Inlet valve opens here. I am drawing the air in the combustion chamber, bottom dead center. Then inlet valve closes and compression is taking place. And compression taking place. And here it is the spark here, and combustion take place, and pressure inside the combustion chamber is increased drastically. You can see, and this is what we call peak pressure inside the combustion chamber. Now, as a designer, what I want, if this is the top dead center TC, this one, and peak pressure is occurring here. So what we prefer, that cylinder peak pressure should occur as close to as possible near TDC. If this pressure is delayed, you will get less torque, less power. So this pressure is just after TDC, maybe 10 degree after TDC, maybe 8 degree after TDC, maybe 12 degree after TDC. And that's why, that is one of the reason that why we are starting the spark before TDC. Now suppose spark I am doing here. So when I am doing this spark, this is like this. So maybe suppose 12 degree before TDC spark, 12 degree before after TDC is a peak pressure. The combustion is completed in say 30 degree crank angle. So that's why I am starting the spark well before top dead center. Now again look at this. If I make it spark more advanced here, then what will happen? Peak pressure will be very close to TDC. It will shift here and it may increase. So that's why a concept is there, MBT timing, minimum advance for best torque. Because if I am advancing it more and more, then temperature and pressure in the cylinder is rising, and it may cause knocking also, and it may not be, it may cause knox formation also. So you have to optimize that. More advanced means more knox. So that's why MBT means minimum advance for best torque. So I make an advance such that engine give me the best torque. Best torque means maximum pressure after TDC. This is the peak pressure. And this diagram is known as P theta diagram. In this is the intake cycle. This is the compression. This is the combustion. So combustion in this case may be generally around 40 degree crank angle. This one, you can see this area is combustion. And then we have the expansion. This is the power stroke. Now here I am opening the exhaust valve. And exhaust valve opens, and then inlet valve opens, then the cycle repeats. Now here my question is, you have seen two valve in an engine, one inlet valve, one outlet valve, exhaust valve. If I show you two valves, the diameter is, suppose one valve diameter is X, another is Y. can you tell me from the shape of the wall which well is intake wall, which well is exhaust wall? Question to all the centers, by looking at the walls, can you judge even into the engine which is intake and which is exhaust? There are two walls, one is for intake, another is for exhaust. By looking, yeah, please.
The larger diameter wall will be intake wall.
Okay.
X is greater than Y, that will be intake wall.
Okay, it means say the wall who has the larger diameter, that will be of intake, right? Anybody else? Okay, so your opinion is exhaust wall should have the larger diameter than intake. Okay, now there are two opinions. One person say intake should be larger, another say exhaust should be larger. So I don't know who is right, who is wrong. Anybody else? From any center, any opinion, the diameter of the wall, which is larger, intake or exhaust? Yes. Very basic question. You have an engine. You open the engine. Somebody has given to two wall. You have to identify which is intake, which is exhaust. How you will tell? How you will judge? From the diameter. From one center, someone say intake wall is larger in diameter than exhaust. But at the same time, I got an opinion from another center. He says exhaust wall is diameter is more than the intake. So now I am confused. I don't know whether intake is larger or exhaust is larger. Somebody can suggest me, somebody can tell me. Here in the studio, the person is saying that intake should be larger. So now I have two opinions. For the intake is larger than exhaust, and one opinion is exhaust is larger than the intake. Which is true, which is false? Anybody from any center? Yes.
This wall should be larger because the volume of exhaust is lower than the mixture of fuel and air.
What you are saying in that volume?
Volume of exhaust gases will be large, will be high.
Exhaust wall diameter should be large. Okay, now I have four opinion. Two say exhaust wall is larger, two say intake wall is larger. 50-50. So anybody else? Are you finding this question very interesting?
The diameter of intake wall is larger than the exhaust because we have to increase the volumetric efficiency.
Okay. So your opinion is that intake should be larger than the exhaust because you want to increase the volumetric efficiency, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now three intake side, two exhaust side. Right? Anybody else? Anybody else from the center? So now, should I tell you the answer? Okay. The correct answer is, what is the correct answer? The correct answer is the intake valve is having the larger diameter than the exhaust. And the reason is not only the volumetric efficiency, but the reason is different. Let me find out that reason. Like if you look at this inlet valve here, because when engine is taking the air flow will take place based on the pressure difference, delta P. So in the air, the pressure is atmospheric pressure. You cannot increase that pressure in a natural respirated engines. So it is a pressure is say 100 kilopascal, one atmosphere. Now piston is moving downward, it is creating some suction. So that may be around say 40 kilopascal. So the delta P is around 60 kilopascal. So that is the pressure difference available which cause the flow. Right? Now come to the exhaust valve side. In the exhaust valve, when I am expelling the exhaust gases, I am opening the valve before bottom dead center here. And when I am opening this valve, the pressure inside the combustion chamber is around 3 to 4 bar. And at outside is 1 bar. So pressure difference is 2 bar. So the pressure difference is more in case of exhaust process. It means if the pressure delta P is more, there is more pressure to push the gases. So they can escape even through the smaller hole. If I am keeping the same, then I will get less air because of the pressure delta P is less in the intake. So I increase the diameter of the intake valve because delta P is less here. And I reduce the exhaust valve diameter because delta P between the combustion chamber, between the engine and atmospheric is more. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, we are going, there are many cycles. I am not touching upon all the cycles. I am touching only two cycles. For spark ignition engine, one is the Otto cycle, and for diesel engine, it is a diesel cycle, compression ignition engine. There are dual cycle, Lenoir cycle, Atkinson cycle, Brayton cycle, gas turbine, Stirling cycle. The petrol engine and diesel engine, which are widely used, they are based on the Otto and diesel cycle respectively. Now, here I would like to touch upon the ideal. Let's look at this cycle, ideal Otto cycle, petrol cycle. It is a theoretical cycle, that's why BDC and TDC, it is isentropic compression, then heat addition in the system, and then isentropic expansion, then heat rejection. So during isentropic compression, constant volume, heat addition at constant volume, you can see the volume remains constant during the heat addition, and the efficiency of this cycle is 1 minus 1 by R gamma minus 1. Now, can anybody tell what is R? Yes. R is the compression ratio. That is total volume of the combustion chamber and oblique clearance volume. Now my question is, if anybody has a car or motorcycle which are operating on petrol engines, what is the compression ratio of commonly in motorcycle and in car engine? What is the compression ratio in the cars and motorcycle engine which you are using? That is my question. Anybody from the center, if anybody has a motorcycle or car, what is the compression ratio of their car of the engine? Now you tell me one, 8 to 10 is, you know, your car cannot have the two compression ratio. Around 8. Okay, anybody else? Anybody have diesel car?
For petrol engine, the compression ratio is 9 is to 1 to 11 is to 1 for petrol.
9 is to 1. 11 is to 1.
Okay.
Okay, so somebody has said 10 is to 1, one has said 7 is to 1, somebody told me 8 is to 1. Yeah, anybody from any center? Okay, let me give the most of the motorcycle engines, they use a compression ratio of around 8.5 to 9.5. And most of the car compression ratio they are using between 9 to 10. Now it is for petrol. Now my question shift from petrol to diesel. What is the compression ratio in the diesel cars? Yes, anyone? What is the compression ratio of in diesel engines? Yes, please. Yes.
Approximately like 4.
Approximately?
13.
13. 18. Okay. So I got one question, one answer. That is 18:1. Anybody else? Okay. So I have from the studio, he say 14:1. I got another, he say 13:1. So I have now three values: 13:1, 14:1, 18:1. Anybody else? Yes. 16. Okay. Now one more value has been added. So 13, 14, 16, 18. Who is right? I don't know. Anybody else? हाँ देख लीजिए आप चलो. You are connected or not yet? Okay. So please tell me when it is connected. भैया पानी है क्या देखने इसमें कोई बोतल में पानी दो इतना पानी लेता हूँ जरा.
एक लैपटॉप में इंटरनेट में प्रॉब्लम आ गई.
क्या हुआ कल के एंड से नेट क्या हुआ
हमारे एंड से
तो इसको आपने रीस्टार्ट कर दो ना अपने स्विच को पावर सप्लाई को रीस्टार्ट करो
सर एक एक लैपटॉप पर चल रहा है दूसरे लैपटॉप पर बंद हो गया ऊपर से फोन आया ऊपर वाले स्टूडियो में बंद हो गया
अच्छा
सर लैपटॉप रीस्टार्ट कर दिया हमने
अगर एक लैपटॉप शो होने से सारा इंटरनेट सारे सेंटर कट ऑफ हो जाते
हैं आधे हो गए
So, welcome back. There was some technical problem, so we were disconnected for a few minutes. Now we are back, and the question was, what is the compression ratio in diesel engines? Of course, we discussed about the petrol engine also. There we are varying the compression ratio depending upon the motorcycle or car, but somewhere it is from 8.5 to 10. That is the limit of today internal combustion engine operating with the petrol. For diesel engines, the compression ratio is ranging from 16 to 20. The high performance engine, they are using around 19, even people has gone up to 20, but most of the engines they are using around 18. That is the compression ratio of the diesel engines. Now, why compression ratio is so important? You look at this. Like I have for gamma 1.3, for gamma 1.4 and for gamma 1.6. Let you take any gamma, for example 1.3 I am taking. So as I am increasing the compression ratio, my efficiency is increasing. So why we are going for higher compression ratio? Because I will get more efficiency. So there are two ways to get the more efficiency. One is the increase in compression ratio. Then gamma, which is Cp by Cv, specific heat at constant pressure divided by constant volume. So that is, if more is the gamma, more is the efficiency. You can see, so this is the working band of most of the engines, 8 to 12, but the compression ratio beyond 10, they need high octane fuel, which is not available in India. So Indian engines are generally operating, upper limit is 10:1. The difference with the diesel cycle is, like we are adding the heat at constant pressure. In auto cycle, it is at constant volume. It was like this. It is like this. And the efficiency of the cycle is same 1 minus 1 by R gamma minus 1 multiply by this factor. So, diesel engine efficiency is, you know, compression ratio of diesel engine generally you can say from 12 to 22, but nowadays there is no diesel. This compression ratio was 30 years before. So now mostly it lies in 18 to 20, and some racing engines go up to 22 also. Now when we calculate the compression ratio, how it is being calculated, let's go step by step. First is clearance volume. The clearance volume in this is the clearance volume. This is the clearance volume, and this green is the clearance volume. So this we call it piston volume, which is the on the crown of the piston. Then this is the gasket volume, because we are using a cylinder head gasket, so that is the volume. And this is the cylinder head volume. So if I am adding all these volumes, I am getting the clearance volume. So clearance volume is equal to cylinder head volume, gasket volume plus piston volume. So this is the VC. Now let's find the compression ratio. This is the VC which we discussed. This is the VD, displacement volume. VD plus VC is the total volume. Divided by the VC, it is the compression ratio of a given engine. So, if you are using a bigger engines, BSFC is bigger, much better than the smaller engines. So, if you see, this is the displacement. A small engine has the higher BSFC. Big engine has the lower BSFC because of the waste energy. Next, we will discuss about the different type of efficiency: mechanical efficiency, volumetric efficiency, combustion efficiency, thermal efficiency, and fuel conversion efficiency. Now my question is now that for mechanical efficiency, you can just, it is very simple, it is the ratio of the brake power delivered by the engine to the indicated power, that is the thermal efficiency. The most important thing is in the engine is volumetric efficiency. Now can anybody from any center, can give me the answer, what is volumetric efficiency? What is volumetric efficiency? What it means? I am not going by definition. What it means? And how it is calculated? Anybody from any center, volumetric efficiency, because it is a very vital parameter of the engines. All the engine design revolve around this. So what is the volumetric efficiency of the engines? Anybody from any center, all are welcome to give their opinion about the volumetric efficiency, what it means, what is the physical meaning of volumetric efficiency, what it means to the engine, how you define it. Yes, please. In this, there is very important aspect is lying. I would like to dwell upon the volumetric efficiency of the engines. What it means to the engine. Yes, please. Anyone from the studio? What is the volumetric efficiency of an engine? What is the physical aspect of this? How you define this?
The amount of air that is going inside the cylinder. How much amount?
Yes,
relative to the actual that can go.
Okay, there is something from the studio. They say the amount of air which is going to the engine by the theoretical amount of the air which engine can suck it. Anybody from any center? So one, So it is, the studio people were little bit on the right path, but still there is, you know, something in this. The ratio of actual air inducted by the theoretical air. What do you tell me? What do you mean by actual air and what do you mean by theoretical air? Because suppose piston is moving, now I'm showing you a picture of the piston. Yeah, okay. This is the volume, right? When the inlet valve will open, this will be filled up with the air or not? So every time it will be filled. So in this, what is theoretical and what is actual? Because air will come and air will fill it.
Pressure,
no, because in during intake, when the air will be sucked in, during intake or during compression?
During intake.
Air is coming in.
During compression, the piston compresses the air.
But what is volumetric efficiency? That the compression do not have any role in that. So when suction is taking place, air is coming through the intake valve. So now if you see this cylinder and piston, the air will come and fill this whole volume. So what do we mean by volumetric efficiency then? Any way it will fill it, there will be air in this. And the this volume is fixed. This, whatever diameter and swept volume is there, the volume is fixed. Suppose it is 1000 cc engine, one cylinder, total four cylinder, 4 liter engine, or 1 liter engine, four cylinder. So each cylinder is 250 cc. So it will take the, so this volume is 250 cc, right? Then how you calculate that volumetric efficiency? Because whenever air is coming, it will fill it. Samjhe na? Anybody for you, any center? Because when I am taking the intake process, air is coming into the combustion chamber. This is the cylinder. Air will come in. Piston is moving from top dead center to bottom dead center. So it is filled with air. Suppose now I am taking a real example. Suppose it is 1000 cc engine. So it will take 1000 cc of air in this, right? So what do you mean by volumetric efficiency? The space will remain same, no? Or you are varying the space. My piston ka to size ho gaya ek bari fix. Apne cylinder is designed. Suppose diameter is 100 mm and stroke is 70 mm. Yes, please.
Sir, volumetric efficiency is the ratio of mass of air, actual mass of air to the theoretical mass of air.
Actual mass of air?
To the theoretical mass of air.
Okay, so how you calculate the actual mass?
The density, of density, we know the volume of the cylinder.
Mm-hmm.
We know the density and volume of cylinder, we can calculate the mass of the air and air.
So it means volume is varying or volume is fixed?
Volume is fixed.
Then what is varying?
Density is varying because of temperature and pressure.
Yes, anybody else? So I got one answer, that volumetric efficiency is the mass of the air. Ratio of the mass of the air, actual versus theoretical. Anybody else? Yes. Yes, now I have indicated you. The person who was telling from center, he was right. It is the mass of the actual air. It is not the volume of the air. I want to emphasize, it is not the volume of the air, because volume of the air remains same. It is the mass of the air actually the engine can suck in, and theoretical. Suppose it is a because we, when you are operating in idling, throttle is closed, so air density will reduce, so mass of the air will reduce, and theoretical is rho A into Vd, that will remain same. Any भैया ये कोई somebody is asking any question or आवाज आ रही है ना काफी उसको हाँ तो वो आवाज ओ so now next is the combustion efficiency. Fuel has certain chemical energy and it is the ratio of the actual heat input by the theoretical heat input and what is the utilized. Q in ratio of the actual heat input by the theoretical heat input. So theoretical may be mass of the fuel into calorific value of the fuel, but that may not be converted completely. So that is the ratio of the combustion efficiency. Generally it is 96 to 99%. Thermal efficiency, relate amount of fuel, chemical energy is converted into actual work. So chemical energy is converted into work, that ratio is the thermal efficiency. Thermal efficiency can be divided by total amount of heat input and the energy converted into work. So now very important aspect, we are coming to some calculations. Suppose I have two cars, both are 1000 cc engine, right? Engine capacity is same. Now I am going in a market, and you are expert on engines, you are faculty in some engineering college. Some person is coming, sir, I have one Maruti car, I have one Centro car, Hyundai, both engines has the same capacity, and one car I have 1200 cc engine, that is also developing some power. Now how you will judge which engine is more better in terms of performance? One thing, they can indicate fuel economy, that is one part. Another is that in terms of power and torque, how you will judge? So the swept volumes is supposed same. So what is the judgment criteria? One criteria is how efficiently the engine is designed. You find out the specific weight of the engine. It means engine weight divided by the power. Suppose one engine is developing 50 horsepower, another is developing 60 horsepower, same volume, and weight is less. So the cylinder which is more compact and which is developing more power, and that is denoted by specific weight and specific volume. So there are two terminology which is very important to compare the engine: specific weight is equal to weight of the engine, divided by rated power. And specific volume of the engine divided by rated power. So it is the volume per liter, it is the power per liter, and it is a, either you can find out the per kg or you can find out the so much kg per kilowatt hour. To produce 1 kilowatt power, what is the weight of the engine? Which is lighter, that will be more efficient. Which is smaller, that is more efficient. So these are the two terminologies, specific weight and specific volume of the engines. Bore and stroke, everybody is knowing. Under scare, square engine, over scare. If bore and stroke are equal, that is called square engine. If bore is less, stroke is more, under scare, and over scare is bore is more than the length. Now, my next question is regarding the how to calculate how to design the engine. Now, nowadays I will take now practical example. Earlier, 1 liter engine was developing 7 horsepower. It means the specific power output of the engine is 7 horsepower per liter. Today, 1 liter engine is developing 70 horsepower, 10 times more. So, how it was possible? We will discuss about this technology, how it has been achieved over the period of time, 10 times more power. So number one, the earlier engine, they were using a compression ratio of 4:1, 3:1, 5:1, that's all. So compression ratio was very low because the technology, the material was not compatible with that. Then what happened? They start increasing the compression ratio. Compression ratio, today engines, they are going up to 10 in petrol. In diesel, earlier it was 7-8, now it is 20. Number one is the compression ratio. Number two, have you seen multi-wall engine? Anybody, any center? Like I told you, first we have the one intake wall, one exhaust wall. Have you seen the engine which has more intake walls and more exhaust walls? Anybody from any center? In one cylinder. You have seen one intake, one exhaust? Aapne bhi one intake, one exhaust? In the studio, some engineers are sitting. They are saying they have seen in one cylinder, one intake wall, one exhaust wall. Anybody, my question is, can I increase the number of intake and exhaust walls? Why I use one? Can we increase it? Have you seen any engine with more number of walls? Anybody from any center? So, one person, Mr. J. Singh, replied yes. He has seen the engine with more walls. Anybody else? Anybody from any center? Have you seen? हाँ ये आ गए, मैं पढ़ रहा हूँ ये. दिस इज या वन पर्सन फ्रॉम, दिस इज जे पी,
दिस इज फ्रॉम मुलाना एंड फ्रॉम बिजनौर, दे आर टू सेड यस.
ओके ओके. नाउ हाउ इट स्टार्टेड, व्हेन वी वर ट्राइंग टू इंप्रूव द पावर, we thought that can we increase the area, like as you mentioned earlier, we told you that intake wall area we may increase, so there is a limit to increase that. So what then tried, can we use two intake walls? So people are started using two intake walls. Then exhaust is also necessary. Then I use the first, the concept came two intake wall, one exhaust. Then concept came two intake, two exhaust. Then concept came three intake wall, two exhaust wall. Have you seen any engine with three intake walls? Nowadays, most of the Maruti car, Alto 800, every car, Wagonr, they have four walls, two intake, two exhaust. So it means today what we have learned, that volumetric efficiency can be increased by increasing the number of valves. Honda has four walls engine in one cylinder, two intake, two exhaust. Then what we started, because there is a port, you know, cylinder head, the coming, it is coming to the port. Then you have two intake port, like you have to merge somewhere one, you know, from the intake manifold when it is coming. So we started a lot of simulation and all that. After 2-3 years, simulation has been done, and the shape of the intake system comes like the nose. And if you feel, as a human being, you have two walls, intake, two port, right? This is one. This is one. Both are working and they are merging at one. When you will be surprised after a lot of trials, lot of experiments, when simulation is done, the shape of the intake port comes like a nose. Because this is the best design. Viscous losses. The flow is easy with the nose.
So how it works with two intake and two exhaust?
So intake, instead of one opening, both intake valve will open. So you have the more area to get in the combustion chamber. There will be two rocker arms. Yes. Number of rocker arms also increases.
Camshaft,
there is a technology, generally we have two camshafts, one for intake, one for exhaust. Yes.
Engine pura design
hi change karna padega. Yes, two camshaft. So what has been done? So now what I was telling you, how to increase the performance power of the engine. So number one is the compression ratio you can increase. Number two, you can increase the volumetric efficiency. And volumetric efficiency can be increased by the using number of valves. Next, you can further increase the power by turbocharger or supercharger. Right? Then another interesting study I was telling you, that if you have seen earlier engines, the cooling fan is directly coupled with the engine. As you start the engine, cooling fan also start operating. Right? When the cooling start operating, you are starting in the morning, you don't require cooling. Engine is cool, you want to heat up the engine, but cooling circuit starts, fan also start, water starts circulating through the radiators. So somebody think this is not good. Then what has been done? The thermostat is done, that one is the thermostat is done, then what else? Idling मतलब नहीं फैन तो देखो जैसे आपने पहले कहा था फैन वॉज कपल्ड विद द क्रैंक पुली तो इंजन स्टार्ट होगा तो फैन तो चालू होगा ही होगा तो कैसे अवॉइड करोगे आप देखो जो क्रैंक शाफ्ट है वो पुली लगती है आपने देखा ना बेल्ट चलती है फिर तो बेल्ट क्या है दैट इज रोटेटिंग द फैन ऑफ द रेडिएटर तो जैसे ही आपने इंजन स्टार्ट किया so that is coupled with that and it start operating so this problem was avoided by using a electric fan so fan was not operated by the directly coupled with the crankshaft it is electrically operated and by using a thermostat so thermostat close rahega water will not go to the radiator it will recirculate in the cylinder head and block so engine will quickly warm up And after some time, when the engine is heated up, then the thermostat will expand and it will open the passage to the radiator. And then cooling fan, again the cooling fan may not start now because it may take the natural air and it is cooled. When even that system is not sufficient, only sometimes the fan will start. So your electrical consumption is your the power consumed by the fan is reduced drastically. That is the another S concept. Then we came to the fractional loss reduction. How the fractional losses has been reduction? The piston rings has been redesigned. The thickness was reduced. The piston skirt length was reduced. Earlier we were using big piston. Now it is shorter piston. So by reducing the fractional losses, it is the old engine they use a stem diameter. Now my next question is, suppose you have a intake valve diameter, suppose 30 mm. Now there is a stem. What is the stem diameter? Ab jo guide bata rahe the na, the stem is going in the guide. It is like that. It is going like this, right? So what is the stem diameter? So there is a relationship between the wall diameter and the stem diameter. So earlier we were using a stem diameter of around, suppose this much stem diameter we were using, maybe 12 mm or 10 mm. Nowadays we are using a stem diameter of 5. And what is the benefit? If I am using a stem diameter of 5 mm, smaller diameter has the less frictional losses, less contact area. Less contact area means less frictional losses, and it will be lighter in weight.
So, diet and
the guide का भी file करेंगे फिर.
वही ना फिर उसपे file करना. File भी
जनवरी थोड़ा clearance तो देंगे. हाँ, clearance मैं कह रहा हूँ. Design point of view मैं बात कर रहा हूँ. वो तो फिर करना ही पड़ेगा सारा वो तो. I am telling you the concept, how to improve the engine. So that all these things has been done. Then crankshaft bearings, and their diameter is reduced. Noble metal has been used. Bearings were changed. Then rocker arm. Earlier we had the tappet type of mechanism. The power was transmitted by the chain drive. Now they are using belt, and there is a overhead cam is coming now. So you need not to have the push rod. So that all these systems, all this integration, piston designing, piston rings designing, combustion chamber designing, wall mechanism, wall train designing, variable wall timings, all this has been put into the new engines and the power since last 30-40 years it was changed from 7 to 8 specific power output to 70 to 60. And then if further you want to increase, you can do that by turbocharging, supercharging. So now I think we have few minutes. I want to spend this 5-6 minutes or 7 minutes on the discussion and question answers. Now session is open for the questions from all the centers. Any question please? Turbocharger, we have special session day after tomorrow. They will talk on turbocharger. Now I am just introducing those things, that these are two power increase. So there will be full session on turbocharging. So that will be covered by Dr. Ramesh. Any question from any center?
Sir, what is this camless technology? Sir, what is this camless technology?
What is
camless technology, sir?
Camless.
Yes, sir. We have sir replaced the valves with we have replaced the cam so that friction losses can be reduced.
Yeah, this is tried actually. Basically, the inlet valve and exhaust valve generally they are operated and open and closing is by the camshaft, and there is a cam on that. But there are certain engines, they are not using the cam. So that is either you can operate the valve pneumatically or hydraulically. So there is that process is known as camless. So you can reduce the frictional losses. There is no camshaft on that. Valve lift is operated by the hydraulic system, and those engines are known as camless engines. These technologies are available.
Thank you, sir.
Because this is little bit expensive, because you have to see the cost factor also. But in where the cost does not matter, in high end cars where the cost is 60 lakhs, 50 lakhs, there we are using this technology. But now we are trying to use in smaller engines also, but cost is slightly increasing. It is a cost factor only, but slowly it is coming up in smaller engine also. Adiabatic engines are still in sort of a research. A lot of research has been done. Low heat rejection engines. But when you are providing a coating on the combustion chamber or on the pistons, that durabilities are the issues in adiabatic engines. So they don't have the longer life. So people are finding out the material which is suitable for the adiabatic engines. Wo already hai, Maruti. Far equipment, because in diesel engine it is more heavier, vibrations are more. So there in diesel engine it is not preferred, but in petrol engine you can have the aluminium engine. Unme to cast iron, because it is compression ratio is very high. So the integrity, the strength should be more. And secondly, vibrations. Diesel engine has more vibrations. Yes.
Can we regenerate catalytic?
Because in catalyst, in three-way catalyst we are using in petrol engine, and there you know there is no particulate matter, so generally catalytic converter choking don't take place. Only the damage to the catalytic converter may happen, that is you know overheating of the catalyst. So but choking or clogging is generally not taking place in catalyst in petrol engines. Can we use
spherical balls to reduce the translational friction?
No, any means to reduce the frictional losses is welcome, but one has to do the research, cost and durability aspects has to be looked upon. So Dr. R.K. Pandey is coming tomorrow. He is talking about the frictional losses reduction in the engines. Yes, any other question? So if there is no question, let me summarize the session. Today we have just developed on the basics of the engines. Yes. Few question?
Yes, sir.
Tell me.
Sir, why does the emission change in long run of the vehicle?
Why?
Does the emission change in long run of the vehicle?
There are many reasons. Number one, due to the wear and tear of the engine, compression ratio of the engine changes. The quality of the ignition system changes, the fuel injector also, you know, some clogging take place, and the catalytic converter efficiency is also reduced. So that's why over a period of 70,000-80,000 kilometers, they affect the emissions.
Can we use a diesel engine or biodiesel without blending?
Can we
use diesel engine? Can we use diesel engine? Biodiesel without blending.
Blend? I think question is not very clear.
Diesel engine on biodiesel without blending.
What do you mean by without? Anyway, the diesel engine can be operated on biodiesels.
Then without blending. Can we run diesel engine on biodiesel?
No, I am able to read that, but that question is not correct. The question is not clear. We can run the diesel engine on the biodiesel, and what he means by blending, that is not clear. One thing is, like, if you don't want to mix the biodiesel in the diesel, then you have a pilot injection, you have a separate fuel. Biodiesel and diesel separately, and you can inject that also, but the system will be very costly.
Blending of biodiesel.
The question is wrong.
This said, can you please quote an example in which quote an example in which inlet valve is bigger than exhaust valve?
Can you please quote an example in which inlet valve is bigger than exhaust valve? In every engine it is there. Whatever engine you open, every engine has this inlet valve bigger than the exhaust valve. Maruti, Honda, Toyota, Hyundai, Tata Motors, Mahindra, Escort. You name the engine, it will have the bigger diameter inlet. Okay, I think with this we close the today session, and tomorrow we are covering CRDI system, about the CNG alternate fuels and about the friction losses reduction in the engines. And I enjoyed to interact with all the centers, and I would like to thank to all the centers which were connected today. I really enjoyed while interacting with you people. There were many good questions, good interaction, and hope this talk on the EGR, on the DPF, on the engine combustion may be fruitful for all of you, and you may use during your teaching and during your research. Thanks everyone, and I thanks to NITTR also for giving me the opportunity to interact with you people. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.